Good morning. My name is Scott Rutledge, Chief Strategic Officer at T3Live.com. It's Monday. Welcome to 2016. So if you turned on your computer screen or the TV, you know, obviously you've seen what's going on overseas. You see that that in China, massive pressure. I think they actually had a halt. The trading in the Shanghai was down about 7%. A lot of other areas in that region also down considerably. Europe, which has also been pretty technically broken as we came into the end of 2015, has the DAX down 4%. So it's putting a lot of pressures on our market. You know, I know we were talking last week about how, you know, we weren't sure which way the market would go to start the year, because sometimes you get new funds come in, new flows, but only when they feel like they have to put it to work. You know, but under the surface, you had most moving averages closing below, you know, or most sectors closing below moving averages, where it wasn't really making people, you know, put risk on. So I think most in the community hopefully had risk down to come into today with a little bit of a, you know, wait and see type of attitude. So if you look here at the chart of the S&P or the SPX, I know I put this on Twitter to show, you know, what the bulls would want to see or what the bears would want to see, and how we could react if we came in somewhat flattish. So the thing that the bears were kind of getting excited about is this series of lower highs. You have a high, lower high, another lower high, and the close pretty much below the 200 day. So today the S&P is opening basically down, or right now at 8 o'clock, it's down about 30 handles. So the question is, you know, can this floor that we held right around Christmas, you know, hold again? Okay, and at this point, you know, no one truly knows. I think the first time we get here, we might bounce a little bit off of it. Okay, but then if we can't really get away from this spot, you know, chances are there could be more downside pressure, you know, coming in here in the next few sessions to as it unravels. Here is the last little moving average around 2024, which was a micro spot that I talked about. So, you know, I guess if we were to hold this 2000 area and close off our lows, maybe that'll relieve a little bit of pressure. But at this particular point, you know, it's hard to tell if that could even be the case. You know, there's not a lot to hang your hat on out there as far as technical strength. Okay, the Qs have been pretty much the strongest sector out there. Let's take a quick look at that. So, you know, if you want to take a look to see what kind of needs to hold here for that to continue, you do have a boatload of support coming in right into this spot. So this area where you see all these moving averages, it's pretty important. Okay, this needs to hold. Otherwise, you know, I don't think there's going to be much else you could look at as far as even strength. What is this? This is, you know, right around this 109. And some guys are saying this is a weird looking head and shoulders pattern, where you have a left shoulder that's too high versus the head and the right shoulder, or just, you know, somewhat of a rounding top. But either way, you know, this has been resistance. Now we'll see what happens here into support. So I would say, you know, you really have to be careful here and write down this 109, 110 area. A lot of support underneath it. So I would think first time, you know, it tries to hold that if it sees it at this point in the morning. In other sectors, though, like you have the Russell, which has been very weak. You had the bios that have been acting pretty fair. If you want to take a quick look at the IBBs, you know, you have two levels to write down. One probably right here. This is, the micro support going sideways, which is right around 328. That's probably where it is this morning opening up. If you want to take a quick look that way, you know, so you could see it a little bit better. This is right around 328. But if that weren't, you know, if that doesn't hold, the same level that I was talking to you about, SPX 2000, comes in a little bit closer to here around 320. So this is, remember, where it broke out from and came in and held, kind of tailed into it. So this 320 area is probably the same level, if you look at the spiders going across, which come in around right here. The spiders level is somewhere around this 200. Look how this is where it broke above. Okay, now this was the support. So you look right here, this, you know, could be the spot to hold, and this has to hold. Otherwise, you know, you could see, you know, something like this really fast, which I, you know, I'm not saying today, who knows, you know, crazy things could happen, but that's your next spot. That's that open gap right there, you know, from 2015. So here you are around 200, and then here's that. And then you also have a small little point of reference right there, I guess, if it were to, you know, cascade below that level quickly, you know, then you got a 198, 94. So what I would do is, if I were you, I would write down in the spiders, you know, this 199.83-ish area. If you happen to have gone home short, because we closed below the 200-day closed on our lows, this is probably a good spot to cover some of your shorts. If we push below this in the first hour, you could see this fast. You could see that, you know, as a spot maybe to, you know, look for some kind of reflex move off of. But chances are, if, you know, we don't come off of this area today and we have a big open hole that doesn't get filled, you know, you would think that at some point even this week, we might even be able to see this area. So again, no need to be a hero. You know, I wouldn't be looking to short the open right away because who knows how things could happen. But again, look at those levels for adjustments. If you went out short, congratulations. Some of you guys were talking about that. You know, you started the year off, you know, on the right foot. If you went out flat, you know, you could use the volatility to make some money. If you happen to have gone out long, you know, use the first hour to salvage the trade. For instance, like if you just went out long a little bit of the spiders and, you know, this morning you're like, okay, I'm going to buy a little bit at 230 and then it goes up to 201.50 and you don't see a lot of stocks rally, you see a lot of things still pressured, you know what, you might have to sell your spiders into 201.50, salvage it and say, oh, you know what, it's not going to fill the gap, I got to be careful. And then, you know, or it comes up there, comes back to where the morning 30-minute low was, breaks it, then you're like, you know what, I'm out of this and I'm just going to wait and see what happens in the first, you know, five sessions of trading, or and not, you know, hold myself and go, you know, go underwater, which you could drown if you go underwater too fast. So, you know, as far as that's concerned, you know, again, look at technology, see if that level that I pointed out holds. You know, you have the level in the bios and you have the level, you know, in the spiders. As far as the FANG names, you know, they, you know, Amazon and Google broke out last week, but then they did a breakout failure, which hopefully you just took the trade, considering, you know, we were talking about, will, you know, people come in and take profits here now that they don't have to pay taxes anymore. So if you look at this pattern here in Google, okay, we talked about the potential of a breakout failure, and pretty much it broke out above this, gave you a nice two-day trade, 1-2, and then broke below it. That should have been your out, okay, especially if you're just a short-term momentum trader. Now the question is, I think, you know, will this hold the 50-day? You know, Google has been above the 50-day moving average pretty much since October. So coming into there, if you're flat it and you did sell into strength, maybe this is worth a look. Okay, this 758-ish area, you know, to me, I would write that down. I would write down, you know, 755 to 760 as a spot, even just for to try it as a trade. You know, the 21-day is higher, but it's already below that. That's at 770. So right here is pretty important for Google. You could do the same kind of concept for Amazon. Amazon also, you know, gave you a bit of a breakout failure. It was a great trade if you happened to be here and you weren't on vacation, right? It broke out above this spot, okay, and then came back below it. You know, so usually, you know, if it's something's healthy, it breaks out and holds this, doesn't come back below it, okay? You know, so at this point, here's your 21-day moving average, which I think if you start buying too early, you can be in trouble. I here would also wait to see if the 50-day, you know, still hangs, you know, still serves as support. So if we see 655-ish today, I would think this is a spot you test. Don't just start buying, because, you know, if profit takers come in, you know, based on the fact that this has been up huge for the, not only last year, but for multiple years, you can get into trouble. So here's your 50-day, and here's the bottom end of that, you know, channel support, which comes in a little bit closer to 638. And this was obviously the 21-day, which we're below. So maybe if it were to come below it and reclaim it, you know, that also would show you something a little bit different. You know, there really wasn't that many other strong high beta names, you know, or FANG names. You know, Netflix, we've talked about how that was getting weaker. I think some people were actually trying to short Netflix. And Netflix, you know, closed below the 50-day on the last day of the year right here. So this wasn't giving you any signals to be long it, you know, actually as the way it closed. I think some people would have actually probably might have even gone out short it. And now, I guess, you know, see how it handles this spot. This is 108. Okay, I think it was downgraded today. And then here's a bit of, you know, trend support. So I would watch this spot, 108-ish. Okay, this gave you that little outside reversal day right here, giving you some clues to get out of Dodge, you know, and then now, you know, this is that spot. So if you come in flat, you know, maybe it's worth a look here right around this 108.50-ish. You know, Tesla gave us a trade late last week also, but everyone knows that they put out their car numbers, so it's almost like you're holding the stock into earnings. If that's what you do, fine, either long or short, You know, so for us, I think we played it for a day and a half move and basically got flat because, you know, I know I don't take stocks into event risk, you know, and at this point, you know, I think those numbers were disappointing. I think there was also a car that kind of blew up out there. And so I would think, you know, this is a spot to watch right around here, this 225 to 223. If Tesla's any good, this is a spot that it probably holds. Okay, if it's, I think, impressive, this would be the spot. So, you know, support 1, 2, 3. But hopefully, you know, you made some money when it broke out here and then it actually gave you 2 extra days. And if you held into it for a great car number, you know what, you took the risk, but it was wrong. You know, same way if you were holding it short, because I think some of you guys were talking about that, I think Luke or whomever, you know, saying they were going to go short, you just got paid. So at this point, though, if you're flat it, you know, here's that area, you know, to watch. You know, I talked about BABA and how the technical pattern looked like it could break above, you know, that 85, 85.50, and it just failed. So it wasn't worth having on if it's not going to get above it. I have the options for January 15th just in case. So at this point, they don't look so great. It is what it is. It's better than me sitting in the stock. This resistance proved to be big resistance. And now the question is, you know, can it hold this spot, which is right around 79-ish? And if not, you know, I guess this is lower end of support, which comes in a little bit closer to 76. So I would think if this wants to stay constructive at all, this needs to hold about, you know, this 79-ish. But with the weakness in China, you know, they're probably going to sell some of these just because of that. So anyway, you know, here's that spot. And if you had the 85 calls with me, you know, I guess we've seen crazier things happen. If not, you know, risk is premium paid. You know, Apple, I don't think anyone's long. I think people were trying to be short that thing. It's been so weak. I've spoken many times about the head and shoulders top pattern in this. I've drawn it many times. I've tried to tell everyone, take your love for your Apple products out of the picture. You know, get rid of the name. And if you looked at just a chart, you would see, you know, this pretty gross looking head and shoulders top pattern with the left, the head, and then this could be your right shoulder. And besides even that pattern here, you know, with the break below, you know, you use my moving average rule, and you know, you look here, Apple, you know, look, sorry for all these lines, but if you know, you like a stock when it's above the 8 and 21 day, well, it broke the 8 and 21 day right there and broke trend support right around this 115. So right here was your spot to get out of Dodge, and then you had a quick move down. Then you had a little bear flag, and then you also had another bear flag right here, you know, which triggered to the downside on the last trading day. So now you have some support down here around 103.50, but it does seem as if, you know, if Apple wants to, you know, this, you know, you can't rule this out. This could easily see this spot, and if it does, that's going to put more pressure on tech. And again, above all moving averages, Apple's great. You know, here turned into that choppy mess before breaking the range, which gave you some clues about last year. And then this was when, you know, the bears took over control again, when it broke back below the 200-day, lost this 115, and it's been weaker ever since. I guess see what happens today. You know, you've seen, you know, crazier things with Apple. They have a buyback program. There's new money that's come to work. Maybe it tries to come in and lead the tape today. So, you know, I wouldn't just press it short if you're not short it because you wanted to short it below 105. But we'll see how Apple performs today. Does it stay weak like it was the last month of 2015, or do some new flows try and come in there? You know, so that's something I'll watch with Apple. You know, oil is up a little bit with the whole Saudi Arabia, Iran situation. You know, see if there's a bid in the XLE. XLE, you know, some people are looking for a potential January effect type of move. You know, if you look at the trend, if you know that the XLE for the past 2 years has been in a downtrend. It broke below the 200-day, you know, last, what was that, in October of 2014-ish. So never reclaimed that 200-day, and it's been a lot weaker. You know, fast forward to where it was at the end of last year. Question is, you know, can this spot hold? And we shall see. This morning it's not down as much as the spiders. Percentage-wise, I think it's close, but this is a spot, okay? This is major support right here, 5821. 5821 is big support. This is the 21-day that's been resistance ever since breaking this head and shoulders pattern. Remember that one? Besides everything else, the left shoulder, head, right shoulder. Here's your wedge. Boom, to the downside. And now, you know, see what happens into this little, this area here. Can this hold? If this doesn't hold and it goes below it, you know, now all of a sudden everyone's going to start talking about, you know, high-yield debt and whether some of these companies are not going to be able to raise money, whether they're going to be these bankruptcies, and that probably takes you back to the HYG, which, you know, at this point has been, you know, battered and bruised and below the 200-day for so long. It did make a decent move off the lows here. So typically things don't become obsessions until they make new threshold lows. And as of this point, you know, for the HYG, that's down here. So that is 78-ish. So at this point, you know, support one, support two, and then boom, that would be a big time obsession point. So see what happens here. So if you want to write that down, this is definitely something traders will be watching, 79.88. And right here is 79.07. And then you have the threshold. Anytime you break thresholds is when markets spike. So in conclusion, you know, you're walking into today, futures are down 30 to 35. At this point, you know, if you're caught in some longs, try and figure out a way to hold, you know, to calm yourself down and trade out of them. Who knows, maybe you buy more in the hole and, you know, futures go lower and it doesn't go down and it goes green. And not only did you make money on what you had long and you made extra on the down futures, but I'm not so sure that could happen. So, but if you're actually in the spiders themselves, you know, just realize that, you know, big support is right around that 200. So I might try and bounce off that 200 first, but if it doesn't get any traction and high beta tech continues to get sold and oil names don't bounce, chances are you could see lower. So you might as well salvage that so you could think a little bit more clear heading into, you know, the days ahead. There is a small build, you know, bid in the metals in the GLD. Still, I guess it's a new year. Maybe they can change composure, but I know it's been very tough. Here's all the moving averages. I guess it would be a win for the bulls if it can get above this 102, 50-ish area and actually hold it. Some would say then you have a little bit of an island bottom, okay, with those two candles. But I still think, you know, you have the futures down 30, so for the GLDs to be up a dollar, it's not like the bulls are taking over or the bugs are bugging out. But again, a move over this would be, and then you'd have another gap to trade against, and then bigger resistance comes in, you know, closer to this spot. I'm probably not going to touch gold today. I'm just, you know, a lot of you guys trade gold, and we'll see if something could change here in 2016. You know, it's hard to remember that at some point gold was trading great. Remember when I talked about 850 can go to $1,500 an ounce, and it went to 1,900 and it was trending well, and you know, you could buy the dips and trade patterns. It hasn't been like that for 2 years. So, you know, when things get into a bear market and gold's been in a bear market, you always think that it's going to have to stay that way for a long time. And sometimes it changes. It's a new year. Well, at this point, you're getting a little bit of a gap up in the metals, in the GLDs, see if they hold. And if they hold and you're in them, you know, perhaps maybe you get a better trade there. And here we are, you know, again, 2016, definitely not the morning that some were expecting, but I think most people probably came in somewhat light because it was definitely a coin flip on which way we would go. Would new funds come in and push us above 2080 in the SPX, or again, would volatility hit like it did in China and the underlying technicals that have been weaker strike and get us below that 2024 and then maybe even below that, you know, that 1995 to 2005. You know, so if you want, make sure you're listening to the radio, you're watching the chat in the VTF. I'll try and tweet a few things throughout the course of the day, and we'll see what happens. And maybe I'll even give you a midday update video-wise. If not, I'll see you at the recap. Good luck today.